Right, we're moving now to session one, the 6 days, context, causes and courses. For those who don't know me, I'm Greg Shapland, Associate Fellow at Chatham House. Before being released into the community, I was for many years at the Foreign and Commonwealth Office working on the Middle East and North Africa. We have two distinguished speakers today, Dr. Ahron Bregman, who is a teaching fellow at King's College London, and Dr. Guy Laron, who is senior lecturer in international relations at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Because we're running short a little late, I'll leave you to look at their biographies, and you can see their impressive list of publications. But let's get started. Guy is going to address the question of why did these states end up at war in June 1967, and Ahron will look at the course of the war itself. And because I want to leave as much time as possible for discussion, questions and answers, I'm going to ask each speaker to speak for 15 to 20 minutes. I think you've been briefed to do that. And I've also been asked to keep this session to an hour. So let's get underway. Ahron first. Please.
Podium here.
Whichever you prefer.
Okay, I'll take the podium.
First I want to thank the organizers for pulling off such an impressive event, which, if I may say so myself, coincides wonderfully with the publication of my own book about the topic. Self-promotion check. Before I delve into the details of the background and the origins of the Six-Day War, I want to start with a general remark. What do historians argue about when they argue about wars in general? So, two major questions. One is whether wars are historical accidents, whether they just happen, or whether there is here intentionality, whether there's some interest group, whether the army or other interest group is interested in a war erupting. And the second question that historians argue about is domestic policies, domestic politics versus foreign policy. So is it the case that states just react to threats, or is it the case that they always have freedom of choice and they can choose from various alternatives, and what decides what they will choose is their unique domestic politics? So basically I will try to present a synthesis that would show that the Six-Day War was the result of both intentionality and certain accidents, that international politics were involved, but also domestic politics in each of the countries that was involved. So, now to the story itself. Let's assume that we have an imaginary time tunnel that can take us back to the night of the 13th of May, 1967, specifically to Cairo, where President Gamal Abdel Nasser is calling his vice president and supreme commander of the Egyptian armed forces, Abdel Hakim Amer. The reason for the telephone call is an intelligence brief which just arrived in Cairo via the Egyptian embassy in Moscow. The Soviets, who had supplied this information, alleged that within 4 to 5 days, Israel would attack Syria. Amer and Nasser meet at Nasser's private residence, a comfortable but not a luxurious villa in a good neighborhood of Cairo. They are about to make a decision that would shake the Middle East. We can stop at this point and ponder a few questions that are lurking in the background, and those would be the questions I would try to answer. Why would Israel want to attack Syria? Why should it concern Egypt? And how were the Soviets involved in all of that? So the drums of war were beating ever more loudly in the Middle East during the summer of 1967. There were several reasons for that. The first was the Arab Cold War. The Arab Cold War is a shorthand for the conflict which had raged in the Middle East during the 1950s and 1960s between conservative monarchies such as Saudi Arabia and Jordan and socialist republics like Egypt and Syria. A feature of that conflict was the habit of Arab kings and presidents to blame each other for not doing enough to solve the Palestine question. None of them wanted to confront Israel on the battlefield, as the Jewish state was perceived as being militarily formidable. Nevertheless, to score points with the Arab public, Arab leaders kept egging each other on. Towards the summer of 1967, this game had become even more intense, and that was one of the reasons that Nasser acted the way he did, to prove to the Arab world that he is still his leader and a regional boss. The second reason for the tense atmosphere in the Middle East at the time was Syria's instability. Between the end of World War II and 1967, Syria had gone through no less than 17 military coups. Internally, it was torn by social conflicts between the conservative, city-dwelling Sunni majority and the poor, rural, and radical minorities such as the Druze and the Alawites. Due to the divide and rule policy that the French implemented when they ruled Syria in the interwar period, it were the minorities that were dominant within the army. And the army became the power base of those minorities in Syria. They used this power base to force various civilian governments, which were dominated by the Sunnis, to adopt redistributive economic policies such as land reform. By the mid-1960s, the military was able to take control over the levers of power in Syria, but its support base was extremely narrow. We're talking about Alawites and Druze who are facing a Sunni majority in the city that absolutely hates them and their policies. They're nationalizing everything, and the rich families in Syria are absolutely against them, and they're in alliance with the Syrian Muslim Brotherhood. So, to defend itself from internal dissent, the Syrian government escalated its military confrontation with Israel in order to produce a rally round the flag effect at home. The military regime did that by supporting Palestinian guerrilla organizations that were planting explosives inside Israel since early 1966. Syria also threatened Israel's access to water by trying to unilaterally divert the tributaries of the Jordan River. These policies caused frequent skirmishes between Syrian and Israeli troops. Every time Syria clashed with Israel, it cried for help, especially from Egypt. In November 1966, Egypt and Syria signed a military treaty that stipulated that Egypt must come to Syria's aid were it to be attacked by Israel. And this is why the question of an Israeli attack concerns Nasser on the 13th of May. He is committed to defend Syria if anything happens. The third reason for the tense atmosphere in the region was Israel's domestic problems. Throughout the years of the Levi-Eshkol government between 1963 and 1969, there had been constant friction between the cabinet and the general staff. While Eshkol was one of the most dovish prime minister ever, the general staff kept insisting, that a hard line should be taken against Israel's enemies. It was the Israeli military who had planned and initiated border clashes with the Syrian army, and lobbied from 1966 for a major operation against Syria. Rumors of this operation had started to leak back to the Arabs toward the summer of 1967. That's the reason why when Amr and Nasser meet on the 13th of May 1967, the information that the Soviets supply about a future attack, a future Israeli attack on Syria, looks credible. At the same time, the IDF was creating elaborate contingency plans for conquests that precisely matched Israel's post-1967 borders. Most importantly, the IDF adopted, the Israeli Defense Forces, adopted a preemptive strike doctrine that left politicians with little choice once Egyptian troops started amassing in Sinai in May 1967. So far that was basically the conventional wisdom, and from this point onwards, I'm putting an emphasis on my interpretation of events. I think that other than the regional settings, we should also note the global context in which the war occurred. For in the decade that preceded the Six-Day War, Israeli, Egyptian, and Syrian generals lobbied for policies that increased Middle Eastern tensions and made war more likely. The civilian leadership in all of those countries could have restrained these generals had it not been thoroughly discredited by simultaneous economic crisis. The source of this economic slowdown was global, and other developing countries were affected similarly. The 1960s, therefore, saw an increase in the number of military coups and regional wars in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. It was for that reason that the superpowers despaired of promoting modernization and industrialization in the Third World, something that the US and the Soviet Union invested billions of dollars in during the 1950s and early 1960s. Instead, under new management, Lyndon Johnson in Washington and Leonid Brezhnev in Moscow, the superpowers came back to an old paradigm, one that saw the underdeveloped areas of the world as an arena for military jockeying. Therefore, superpower involvement in the Middle East added fuel to the fire. The Americans sold weapons to Israel in a way that emboldened Israeli generals, and the Soviets made promises about future military backup in a way that emboldened Arab generals. All this helps to explain why on 14th of May, Nasser, following the meeting with Amr that I discussed earlier, mobilized the largest army in the Middle East and ordered it to move east into the Sinai Desert. Amr represented the army, and Nasser, the civilian leadership. Nasser at the time was completely dependent on the army for the continuation of his rule because Egypt was in the depth of an economic and social crisis. There were many signs of that crisis. One of them was that basic food staples were missing from the markets, and factories went idle because Egypt did not have the money to buy spare parts. In the past, Amr advocated exactly for this kind of move, sending the army into Sinai, and Nasser resisted. But in May 1967, Nasser was not strong enough politically to resist, and so he accepted Amr's proposal. The vast arid peninsula of Sinai had lain free of soldiers for about a decade, thanks to an informal agreement between Israel and Egypt. Nasser was thus the first to change the regional status quo. In response to Nasser's action, Israel started mobilizing its troops. Other Arab countries, fearing a confrontation, did the same. On 22 May, Nasser upped the ante by closing the Straits of Tiran, thus blocking the naval route through which Israel imported most of its oil. Nasser did that partly to placate Arab criticism that he was merely bluffing, and didn't really intend to fight Israel, and partly because Amr had assured Nasser that the army was ready for war, which wasn't true at all. As if this was not enough, on 30 May, Jordan signed a defense pact with Egypt. Jordan ruled at the time over the West Bank, and the Palestinians living there went out into the streets in force to demand King Hussein, the King of Jordan, to join the looming war to liberate Palestine. Moreover, many of the senior officers in the Jordanian army were Palestinians, and they told King Hussein bluntly that they could not ensure the army's loyalty if he, Hussein, would not join the war. This made Hussein mount a light plane, the king was a certified pilot, and fly himself to Cairo. Within hours, Nasser and Hussein signed an agreement that put the Jordanian army under Egyptian command and permitted Iraqi troops to cross the border into Jordan and take positions near the front. That was a crucial event. At the time, there was heated discussion in Israel as to how to respond to Nasser's defiance. The new military agreement between Jordan and Egypt strengthened the hawks, and especially the Israeli generals that advocated a preemptive strike. And they could say, look what Hussein and Nasser did. The noose is closing on Israel's neck. Now, as in Egypt, the civilian leader, Eshkol, was fighting for caution, patience, and a diplomatic route out of the crisis. However, exactly as in Egypt, there was an economic crisis in Israel, which was less severe, but was just as harmful to the authority of the civilian leader. Eshkol, as a finance minister in the 1950s, presided over a booming economy. However, in the 1960s, he was the harsh face of recession. Eshkol, on the eve of war, was an unpopular commander-in-chief, and so his coalition partners and his party turned against him. Eshkol fought like a lion for 3 weeks to give negotiations a breathing space. But when he found out in the 2nd of June that basically Washington is unwilling to lift a finger break the blockade that Nasser imposed on the Tyran Straits. Sure, no problem. Okay. Take some responsibility. So when Eshkol found out that not only Washington would not help to solve the crisis diplomatically, but also that Washington was kind of hinting, winking to Israel to start the war, he understood that he had no backup, neither political nor international, to solve the crisis by diplomatic means. And on the 2nd of June, Eshkol gave up and agreed to green light an attack. So now you know why Amr Nasser found the information they received on the 13th of May credible, why they cared about Syria being attacked by Israel, and how the Soviet Union was involved in all of it. And 3 days after the Israeli cabinet made the decision, Israel launched its offensive, and the rest, as they say, is history. Aaron, you can take it from here.
Thank you very much.
Aaron, can we put the map of Israel and the... Yeah, okay. I'll start without it anyway. I have 20 minutes, and I'll try to behave myself. With your permission, I would like to dedicate my short presentation to my dear friend, Miriam Eshkol, who died recently. I met Miriam. She was, of course, the wife, the widow of Prime Minister Eshkol, who led Israel before, during, and after the 1967 war. I met Miriam for the first time when I was working on a BBC TV documentaries, The 50 Years' War, program two of which focused on the 1967 war. And Miriam lived in Jerusalem in a large flat, but she would sit with her guests in her tiny kitchen, overlooking the oven. Above the oven, there was a cut-out figure of Golda Meir, whom she hated. And she would say, "I'm boiling her slowly, slowly." And in the oven, there was the famous Miriam Eshkol's cheesecake, which she served to guests from Ben-Gurion, Rabin, Golda, and I, of course, tasted it too. When the programs were ready, already with the BBC, I rushed to Jerusalem with a small tape recorder to record Miriam singing the song that Eshkol hummed, sang to her on the 4th of June 1967, the day before the war. They were together in the Midrasha, the headquarters of the Mossad just north of Tel Aviv in Herzliya, and they took a stroll in the garden there, and he started humming this Hasidic song, which he liked. I'm not going to sing it for you, but it went, "The rabbi has ordered us to be glad because harder days are coming." And she stopped him and said, "What's going on?" And then he said, "Well, tomorrow war will start. There will be orphans, there will be widows, there will be bereaved parents, and who knows what the new day will bring." You can hear her singing this song and talking about the 1967 war in program two of, thank you, of the 50 Years' War. And I hope she rests in peace after very difficult years. Thank you so much. I will now say a few words about the course of the war, because this is what I was asked to do. The general plan was for the Israeli, not Jerusalem, but the big one. This is Jerusalem. The general plan, excellent. Yeah, that's good. Thank you so much. You can just, that's fine. The general plan for the war was for the Israeli Air Force to surprise the Egyptians, the Egyptian Air Force, and destroy it mainly on the ground. The Israeli ground forces then would engage the Egyptian forces inside the Sinai. If Jordan or Syria, or Jordan and Syria joined the war, the Israelis would then turn on them and deal with them. On the 2nd of June 1967, at a military meeting in Tel Aviv, Moshe Dayan approved the war plans for the ground forces in the Sinai. You see, Moshe Dayan was appointed defense minister the day before, 1st of June 1967. The 1st of June was a very important day in the history of the Six-Day War for three reasons. Number one, this was the day when an Israeli envoy was in Washington asking for permission to go to war, Meir Amit. The second reason was that Moshe Dayan was appointed defense minister. The third reason, the most important of all, it was my birthday. It was my 9th birthday. I still remember the morning when my father came to my bed with a folded newspaper, the picture of Moshe Dayan there, saying to me, "Son," it was very dramatic, "the state of Israel has just given you a present for your birthday." They nominated Moshe Dayan to become the defense minister of Israel. I, of course, was 9. I wanted a toy, but I looked at him, and he looked like a pirate with a black eye patch, and I knew that pirates always win wars, and I was happy enough. On the 2nd of June, Dayan gave his instructions to the military. The first one was "We will start from the air," he said, "and then you will move to the south to open there a charm sheikh, you can see at the bottom, the Straits of Tehran, which Nasser declared to be blocked on the 23rd of May. And then there were two don't do instructions. Number one, do not reach the Suez Canal. Stop 30 kilometers to the west of it. You can see the Mitla Pass. There are mountains. Stop there, at the mountains. Because what he wanted was that after the war, the Egyptians could operate the Suez Canal. His calculation was that if British, French, American ships go up and down the Suez Canal, there will be no war. You can't fight when there are ships there, and if Egypt decide to block the Suez Canal, they will lose a lot of money. His second don't do, was don't occupy the Gaza Strip. He said, and I'm quoting from an interview with Yeshayahu Gavish, who was the commander of the Southern Command in 1967. He said to them, "You must not take the Gaza Strip. Let the Arabs stay there. I don't want anything to do with them. We will be outside. They will be cut off inside. Let them eat each other. I don't want us to be inside there." So these are the instructions, what they have to do when war starts. I'll now say a few words about the air attack, the preemptive attack. 186 Israeli airplanes took off from Israeli bases in the morning of the 5th of June, 7 o'clock in the morning. They flew to the west, to the sea. Here I read to you the testimony of Ran Peker, one of the best pilots, he died recently, who participated in this air attack. He said, "We flew," again, they flew to the west, to the sea. "We flew at a very low altitude, just above the sea, at the height of the waves, then over the sand dunes. We flew at an altitude of less than 100 feet. We flew low over the delta. Farmers were waving to us, probably thinking we are Egyptian aircraft. We arrived at a point from where we had to climb for our attack. It was exactly 7:45 in the morning. We pulled up to 6,000 feet. I looked down and saw the Egyptian MiGs parking on the sides of the runways with the pilots sitting inside the cockpits. I looked to my right and I saw fire and smoke coming from all other bases. It was then that I realized that we had managed to surprise them." It was a very good plan. But the Israelis, I think it was Karl von Clausewitz who said in On War that there are no miracles in war, no miracles in war with me, but he said that luck is very important in war, and the Israelis were very lucky with the morning of the 5th of June. Because when the 186 airplanes made the way to bomb the Egyptians, one single Egyptian airplane was going the other direction. Inside it, the entire Egyptian command, including Amr, including Badran, Minister of War, who lives here in Plymouth, by the way, they went to the desert to visit the soldiers. Everyone was nervous. They've already been there for 3 weeks. So they ordered the radar systems to turn off the radar system. Now, if you turn off the radio system, it is as if I covered your eyes with cloth. And I can then do whatever I want. I can punch you. I will not do that. But I can. Because without the radio system, they are blind. So when the entire Israeli Air Force is on the way to Egypt, the Egyptians can't see them. Interestingly enough, the Jordanians could identify on their radar system in Jordan 186 dots, Israeli airplanes going in the direction of Egypt. They found the Egyptians. They sent to them, Einab, 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 grapes, grapes, grapes. You are under attack. They will come, they will get you in 45 minutes. The Egyptians changed the code the day before. They couldn't understand what Einab, Einab, Einab meant. And they were attacked. I'll say some words about the ground attack in the Sinai. Then the ground forces, Israeli ground forces, went into the desert. I've interviewed Ezra Weitzman, a former military commander of the Israeli Air Force, not in 1967, before. He had nothing to do in 67. So he decided to go with the forces that landed in Sharm el-Sheikh to open the straits, because he thought that this is going to be the event of the day. He said to me, we got there, there was nobody there. Israel went to war because Nasser declared the closure of the Straits of Tiran, or this was the last straw for the Israelis, but there was nobody there. Then the other forces moved into the desert, overlooking Dayan's instructions. They've occupied the Gaza Strip, and they reached the Suez Canal and occupied it. In hindsight, Dayan was right, because with Israeli forces on the bank of the Suez Canal, 180 meters, it's like the Thames here, or less than the Thames. The Thames is 200 meters. I measured it. I know. I mean it. It's 180 meters of the Suez Canal. They could see each other, Israelis and Egyptians. The Egyptians imposed on the Israelis a terrible bloody war, the war of attrition, from 1968 to 1970. And they kept the Suez Canal blocked until June 1970. As for Gaza, which was occupied, Israelis were stuck there for 38 years until Sharon decided to get out of there. You see, Dayan, he was blind. He had only one eye. But with this one eye, he could see to the distance better than many of us who had two or even four eyes like me. And this is one of the tragedies of this war. I'll say a few words about Jordan. The Israelis sent a message to King Hussein of Jordan through the United Nations to tell him, this is between us and Egypt, you keep out. If you keep out, we will not touch you. I don't know if they meant it, but this was the message. But with half of his people Palestinians, Hussein felt that he had little choice. He would prefer to be a loser than a traitor, and he opened fire in Jerusalem and along the Green Line, and he also sent a few airplanes to bomb Kfar Saba and other places. Then Israeli forces moved into the West Bank and just occupied it, and they crossed over to the East Bank. The king phoned Washington saying, the Israelis are coming to Amman, stop them. Washington phoned Israel, and Dayan instructed the forces to go back to the West Bank and to blow up the bridges. And to make sure, he said to them, that you are on the West Bank. The cabinet was divided regarding what to do with Jerusalem. Dayan was opposed occupying Jerusalem. He wanted to surround it and not to enter Jerusalem. Interestingly enough, 5 minutes, I'll finish here. It was a very short war, so we don't need so much time. Yeah. The religious party Mafdal, interestingly enough, they also opposed taking Jerusalem. The leader said, if Israel occupied Jerusalem, rather than we own Jerusalem, Jerusalem would own us. But with growing pressure in the government, which included Begin, the right-wing parties, the decision was made on the 7th of June 1967 to occupy Jerusalem. Soon after, the government removed the no man's land, the separate Jerusalem. Until 1967, Jerusalem is separated, like Berlin, Nicosia, like Hebron now. Now, on the 29th of June, they removed the no man's land, they unify the two parts of Jerusalem, the East Jerusalem, which is 6 square kilometers, with the 38 square kilometers, which are West Jerusalem. We will not show it on the map because I don't have time. And they united the two parts, added to it 28 villages around Jerusalem, and created a big Jerusalem. You see, just one comment about the king. The king, for me, is a tragic figure. Because in 1967, when it was not a good idea to attack Israel, he was the only one to attack Israel. 6 years later, in 73, in the Yom Kippur War, when the Arabs did quite well, and it was a good idea to join, he decided to keep out. So this is King Hussein. Finally, Syria. The only state, the only Arab state, it seemed, that would survive the war intact was Syria. They were very careful not to provoke the Israelis. They only sent symbolic forces to attack a kibbutz, Dan. Eshkol and the ministers wanted to attack Syria. Dayan opposed. He was afraid that the Soviets will join the Syrians in joining against the Israelis. Also, the Syrians, in his view, were not a threat to Israel. Let me quote him, an interview he gave. He said, look, it's possible to talk in terms of the Syrians are bastards. You have to get them. And this is the right time. And other such talk. But that is not policy. You don't strike at the enemy because it is bastard, but because he threatens you. And the Syrians, on the fourth day of the war, were not a threat to us. But there was growing pressure on the government to occupy the Golan. Israeli farmers wanted to have the Golan fertile land. A delegation of them appeared before the ministers to urge them to order the military to occupy the Golan. Dayan opposed it. He said about it, I can tell you with absolute confidence, the delegation that came to convince Eshkol to take the heights, they were thinking about the Golan land. Listen, said Dayan in the interview, I'm a farmer too, and I know about it. I saw them and I spoke to them. They didn't even try to hide the greed for the land of the Golan. With growing pressure on the cabinet approved the attack on the Golan Heights and it was occupied. On the eve of the war, there were 138,000 Syrians living on the Golan Heights in 139 villages, 2 cities, and 61 farms. By the end of the war, only 6 villages remained with 6,000 Syrians. It's exactly 20 minutes, I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you to both our speakers for excellent presentations. Let's go to questions, answers, and comments. If you're going to make an intervention, please tell us your name and your affiliation, and please bear in mind the Shapland doctrine, which states that brevity is next to godliness. Lady there. Could you wait for the microphone?
Yeah. You know, Dr. Ahron, Moore Kingston University. 2 questions. I don't think it's working. It is. Oh, okay. Right. One to Dr. Bregman. I found it very interesting what you say about Dayan, and I'll tell you why. In 1957, was Ben-Gurion that really put a lot of pressure on Dayan to convince him to leave Gaza, saying, that, you know, it would be a base of terrorism against Israel. And Dayan wanted to leave, to stay in Gaza. So this kind of switch, and the portrayal of Dayan almost as a peace-loving person is a little bit strange to me, knowing Dayan. And the other question is to Dr. Laron, and that's about the contingency plans, that you say that once the contingency plans were there, it was very difficult for every, in a way, kind of Israeli government not to strike. And also, the, just very briefly, the military-civil relation in Israel, it's very true what you said, but it's also about not just the Eshkol was actually facing a lot of pressure from the military. It's a problem in civil military relationship in Israel, where you actually always have people who are chief of staff and now they are defense minister. And if they are not the prime minister, like Rabin, they're always facing pressure from the military, right? Especially somebody like Eshkol with the way he was portrayed in Israel. So I think it's something that it's not just Eshkol face, it's something which is very deep rooted in Israeli foreign and defense policy.
Right. About, so I'll start with Dayan, okay? About Moshe Dayan, peace-loving man. Look, he was one of the most important people, you know, involved in the peacemaking with Egypt. So he was, but look, he was rational. He was rational. And about Gaza, he was very, very angry about it. I interviewed the person who occupied it, Yeshayahu Gavish. He described to me how a helicopter landed near his headquarters immediately after the occupation. And out of the helicopter emerged Moshe Dayan, holding, you will know, Tempo, a juice in his hand. He went out of the helicopter and he said to Yeshayahu Gavish, "You disobeyed me, and I'll take you to court." He turned around and left. This was the only thing that he did. He came to say to him, of course, he never took him to a court, because Dayan himself, the chief of staff before that, encouraged the people, you know, to be bold, to be daring, to do things. But now, in 67, these are his instructions. Don't occupy the Gaza Strip, don't get to the Suez Canal, and I don't want this Syria. It's not about peace, I think, it's about being rational.
Okay, if I may add something to that, I think the point is that Dayan never believed a peace agreement with the Arabs is possible. So he always thought about ways to manage the conflict. So I think that's the story behind the instruction not to occupy Gaza and not to reach the Suez Canal, but he would never be willing to sign a peace agreement with them, in my humble opinion. As to the question about the contingency plans, this is one of the best kept secrets of Israeli historiography. The plans that the IDF, that the Israeli Defense Forces implemented in 1967 had been written already in 1953. So this is why I said that the IDF spent a decade and hundreds of millions of dollars to perfect the plan that it implemented in June 1967. So perhaps the Israelis were lucky. You always need luck in war, but there was a meticulous planning that went into that. And the idea behind the airstrike was that the superpowers would intervene. In any Arab-Israeli war, they would intervene. So the question for the general staff in various years and various general staffs until we get to 1967 was how to get maximum territory in minimum time. So if you get air superiority, you can back up the ground troops and then they can advance more easily. And the plan in general was not just to take just territory per se, but to put Israel's borders on what they called the natural lines. The natural lines of Israel, according to those plans that were written first in 1953 and then updated every 5 years, despite instructions by various prime ministers not to do that. Both Ben-Gurion and Eshkol said, we don't need more territory. But the army kept planning towards that. So the natural lines were the Suez Canal in the south. That's why they disobeyed his order. That was the plan from the beginning. to reach the Suez Canal in the south, the Jordan River in the east, Litani River in Lebanon in the north, and the Golan Heights. So all those areas like natural anti-tank canals and lines, easily defendable. Of course, after the war, they suddenly find out that they don't have enough manpower to man the new lines. Nobody calculated how many soldiers you would need to do that. And then you start to believe in all sorts of unicorns and magical thinking like that, I don't know, 100 Israeli tanks on the Golan Heights would stop the whole Syrian army if it decides suddenly to attack, or that the intelligence corps can give you a reliable advance warning. And you're right that there's always friction, between, not just in Israeli history. There's always friction between generals and civilians, but when the economic situation is tough and when the civilian leadership built its legitimacy and popularity on conducting the economy well, and that's true both for Nasser and Eshkol, okay? Up to 1967, up to the mid-1960s, they presided over booming economies. Those economies were growing 10, 8%. That's, you know, countries in Europe dream about a data like that. So when that happens, they're weaker. They can't impose their will on the generals. Yeah, and one last thing. Every time I go to those contingency plans, people say, yes, that was in the drawer. It was a contingency plan. Nobody intended to implement them. Historians have the same kind of discussion about the Schlieffen plan, okay, and Germany culpability in the outbreak of World War I. So I'm with the camp that says, yes, Germany was to blame.
Ian Black there at the back.
Thank you, Ian Black from the LSE. I thank you very much for your presentation. It was very interesting. I'm struck by an absence from what you've both said. I mean, I don't want to be unhistorical. Today, 50 years on, people look at the conflict between Israel and its neighbors, and they focus almost exclusively on the Palestinians. There hasn't been a war, as Asher Susser pointed out, for 44 years. There are peace treaties between Egypt and Jordan, and the Palestinians are currently the focus and have been now for many years of people who follow and are concerned about the conflict. Now, I don't want to be unhistorical again. I know that in 1967, the Palestinians, the word itself wasn't used, certainly not in English, certainly not in Hebrew. And it is wrong, of course, to cast back into time something that wasn't very present. However, it wasn't absent, and this is really my question. The PLO had been founded in 1964. Fatah has conducted its first military operations against Israel from 1965. There was an awareness, certainly, of the issue. People only had to remember 19 years back what had happened. In the context of everything you've described, including the military plans, the lines of the Jordan, Gaza was an interesting point from Eshkol, I think you said. But was nobody thinking about what was going to happen to these people, Palestinians, Arvei Eretz Yisrael, whatever they were called? Did nobody think about that in the run-up to this momentous event, whose consequences, as we know, everybody is living with today? That's my question.
The IDF started planning the occupation of the West Bank from at least 1964. And that year, there was a senior officer, Chaim Herzog, who was later the president of the State of Israel, was appointed the governor of the West Bank. That was his position. He did it as a reserve officer, but he devoted a few weeks every year to be updated about what's going on in the West Bank. He got intelligence briefings. And he recruited people that would help him to plan the occupation. The second thing that happened is the legal unit in the army started planning towards the occupation of the West Bank, again, from 1964. That was the year in which people in Israel thought that King Hussein is about to be toppled. So then the IDF started thinking seriously about occupying the West Bank, and there were orderly courses to legal officers to prepare to be judges and governors of various districts in the West Bank. And there was a special course for Israeli officers at the Military High College to prepare them to be military governors. They even printed copies of international laws relating to military occupation, then translated them into Hebrew, and they prepared orderly kits. They put them in boxes, and they waited in Jaffa, in a big storage house, for about 3 to 4 years. So the planning for the occupation of the West Bank was meticulous. Probably there was some plan, I will say it delicately, because it's a delicate subject, but probably there was some plan about encouraging Palestinians to leave once the IDF enters. Uri Avneri, who was at the place, he's a famous Israeli journalist, he said that when he was in the West Bank, he met soldiers that told him that they were implementing an orderly plan to send the Arabs out before the outbreak of the war. Uzi Narkis, who was the commander of the Central Command and therefore responsible for the campaign against the West Bank, he said, if the government would give us a green light, we can kick the Arabs out of the West Bank in mere 48 hours. So if you're asking about planning, that's my answer. And if you're asking about the Palestinian role in the conflict that leads to the war, so I mentioned the Fatah units and the fact that the Syrians spread their wings over the Fatah and helped them train, they gave them money, they even gave them some intelligence officers to instruct them how to enter into Israel. But at the same time, I would argue that Palestinian activity, despite what you know Palestinian historians would write, they were not an independent factor. They were not strong enough, and without the Syrian encouragement, help, and support, they would have been largely ineffective.
If I can, I'll be very short.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so we have more questions. I disagree with Guy here. Regarding Uzi Narkis, the military commander, like many other Israeli commanders, he never waited for instructions for the from the government what to do. He expelled left and right and right and left. He put a bus at the Hebron gate during the war with a sign to Amman, free of charge. So there was expulsion there, what we are talking about. Now, about preparation for the occupation, zero before the war. Maybe there were some plans, but deep in the drawer. You know, the military commanders on the ground, the occupying forces, had many problems. They had no idea what to do with this problem. For example, it was June, July. There was so much fruit and vegetables on the West Bank. So what to do with all of this? So some of the vegetables were exported to the United States. The army started to have 5 fruits a day because there was so much. And military commanders on the ground decided, okay, we are going to try and export it to Jordan. So they kept blind eye, allowing trucks to take vegetables and fruit from the West Bank, cross the river, and on the other side, Jordanian vehicles were waiting, and fruit was exported. And then came the political level. Moshe Dayan came, said, wow, that's a good idea. We can do open bridges. And there was a new policy of open bridges. We are going to export and import. In other words, just to cut a long story short, the military acted and the civilians prepared nothing and preferred, in fact, not to give instructions. You know, if you go to the Western Wall, to what the British called the Wailing Wall, in front of it, before 67, there was a neighborhood, the Maghrebi neighborhood. It was razed to the ground during the war. The government didn't ask the military to do it, but the military decided that it's a good idea to do that. And now you have a good, a big plaza in front of the Western Wall. What I'm trying to say is that the military took the initiative also after the war, and they did things which were not planned in advance.
Next question is from Professor Galia Golan in the front here.
Galia Golan from the Hebrew University. A couple really quick things. One is that there is this yellow light from Washington that's discussed, but in the, I had occasion to go into the LBJ archives, and in his personal letters, you can see after the war, he was really angry, and he claimed that he had said, if you go alone, you'll be alone. He claimed that it was very clear what he meant. It's generally been believed, I think, that the defense ministry, the state, in the United States, the Pentagon was more positive, maybe actually gave the green light. In the government, don't forget the government was divided prior to the war. I mean, there was the one vote that was theoretically 50-50. Abba even says it wasn't 50-50, but theoretically it was. And the army was pushing the argument they were using, amongst others, with deterrence, with the same argument as in 1956 as well, for going to war, for initiating war, because the army in 67, the argument was that they didn't care about the diplomacy, and even if diplomacy succeeded, it would be bad for us because we'd lose our deterrence factor. The last thing I wanted to say, I thought for a minute on you were, when you said that Diane said not to take Gaza. I was in that war, and I was on the Gaza front, and I remember the battle going out for Gaza. Now, that's why I thought it was very strange that Diane didn't want it, but I accept your argument that Gavish did it without instruction, but we certainly did it.
Oh, of course, yes, of course. Of course, it's about Gaza. If I may take her question about Washington and whether or not they gave Israel permission. On the 28th of May, Abba Ibn was there, and he met with Johnson. And Johnson said to him, more or less, don't you dare. Not only that, he took out of his pile a piece of paper, and he read it to him. So, you know, there's a document. But then on the 1st of June, the famous 1st of June, in fact, last day of May, the Israelis sent another emissary to Washington, Meir Amit, head of Mossad. I interviewed Meir Amit and Robert McNamara, who was a defense secretary there, and they met. And Amit said to McNamara, we are going to go. We understand your situation in Vietnam. You don't need your help, but we are a nation in arms. We can't wait. We are all mobilized for 3 weeks now. McNamara said to him, his answer, the exact words, I read you loud and clear. So it was not a green light to go to war, but it was amber. Amit said, and you can see it in program two, because we put it there. Amit said, I understood from him that we can go. McNamara, immediately after him, you can hear him saying, he asked no question, he got no answers. So there was an amber light from Washington.
Mayor Amit, spoke with him, and he said that McNamara gave green light or approved the White House.
I don't believe that McNamara would have given it without Johnson knowing. They understood that, you know, the Israelis mobilized for 3 weeks now. You know, the Israeli government can either demobilize or go to war. And I think that Johnson knew about it. I think so. I believe so. Yeah.
Go ahead.
My version, I didn't talk to anyone, but there are the documents. And now we have the documents relating to the Amit visit and in Washington, the CIA reports of his visit, and other stuff. There were signs from Washington from the 15th of May, and they grew louder over time, that the best solution to the crisis would be that Israel would go it alone. Now, there's, Ronnie mentioned the famous meeting between Ibn and Johnson. But one day later, before Ibn embarks back to Jerusalem, he meets Arthur Goldberg. And Arthur Goldberg and Lyndon Johnson are like this, okay? And Goldberg tells it to him straight. I know you met with Johnson. I heard the entire report of what happened. Now you have to understand, Lyndon Johnson can't do anything for you without an approval of Congress. And an approval from Congress would not happen, period, because of Vietnam. And you have to understand it because people's lives are dependent on that. So that was an unmistakable signal from one of the president's closest advisors. And there were others. Now, the fact of the matter is that the IDF wanted to attack, so it was more willing to believe that Washington would approve. But nevertheless, Aral Yariv was the head of military intelligence. From an early stage, he asked Avram Lief, he was the head of the superpower desk, to prepare a file known as the green light file, in which all the evidence coming from Washington allowing Israel to attack was documented. And even before Amit even went to Washington, the military intelligence was convinced that Washington would approve of an Israeli operation, although it would do anything to distance itself from it. And the fact that Eshkol appointed Dayan as the Minister of Defense had everything to do with it, because there are all sorts of versions why Eshkol appointed Dayan. Eshkol and Dayan hated each other. They absolutely loathed each other. And Eshkol finds out about 2 hours before he appoints Dayan that he got a sign from the highest authority in Washington, Judge Fortas, that Lyndon Johnson would approve of an Israeli operation, and that an American operation to open the blockade on the transit won't happen.
Okay, thank you. Well, I said I would draw this session to a close at 10 minutes past 11, and that's what I'm going to do. Thank you to everyone who intervened with such excellent questions and comments, and particular thanks, of course, to our speakers. Please give them a round of applause.